In this lecture, we'll learn about Bosanisk approximation for modeling density stratification in free convection flows. There are two important assumptions in Bosanisk approximation, but before that, let's see what is the motivation to obtain this approximation. We saw in an earlier video that we need an unstable density stratification, that is heavier liquid over lighter liquid in the presence of a fluctuation to generate free convection. Now, the density stratification can happen because of density dependence on temperature, and the temperature is changing in changing spatially, or the concentration, dependence on concentration, which concentration is changing spatially. So that is the motivation for including density stratification. Now, how do we model this in our equations? There are two parts to this approximation, and that is due to the French mathematician Bosanisk, and it's called as the Bosanisk approximation. Firstly, it is assumed that the density can be expanded in a Taylor series. That is, it is linear with temperature or linear with concentration. So this term is partial rho by partial t times delta t. And this is partial rho by partial c times delta c. So this is the first approximation, that the density can be expanded about some average density rho naught. The second term is that this linearization is applied only to the gravity term rho g, which comes in the momentum equations. In all other equations, wherever we get rho, we simply use the mean density. So these are the two parts to the approximation. So let's see how it is done. Firstly, consider a vertical plate, which is hot, and at far away the temperature of the air or fluid is cold. Because this is hot and this is cold, if you consider a packet which is here, this packet is subjected to a upward pressure force coming from the buoyancy force. Now this is the edge of the plate, and below this the flow is quiescent, but just at this place is where the instability grows and then it begins to develop. So very similar to a flow over a flat plate, we have a region of boundary layer where there is velocity variation. However, unlike in the case of the forced convection over a flat plate, at far away, the fluid here is quiescent, that is, velocity is zero. But the nature of the boundary layer remains the same. So to recall the equations we derived for flat plate in the boundary layer, so these are the inertial terms, the viscous term, and now we have an additional rho g term because there is gravity. This pressure term here, if you recall, is the pressure outside the boundary layer. So in the case of boundary layer, the pressure outside and inside are same along the along any x. And the variation inside the boundary layer along x is same as the variation in the outside region along x. So that's why P is written as dP by dx, whereas others are all partial derivatives inside the boundary layer. Now, very far away, that is in this coordinate y tending to infinity, the velocity is zero. It is a quiescent fluid. So if you put velocity equal to zero here, then we have only two terms remaining, that is dP by dx equal plus minus dp by dx minus rho g equal to 0, or dp by dx is minus rho g. Now, substituting this, so this is pressure distribution at far away. And since the pressure distribution far away is same as the pressure distribution inside, we can substitute rho g here. And the equation is rewritten now as rho g, rho infinity minus rho by g, times g. And then we divide uniformly by rho. So you have this rho going away here, and you have rho infinity minus rho by rho, and this mu by rho becomes mu. So this term, rho infinity minus rho times g, is same as the term that we derived for the buoyancy force. Now here it is not force, but it's divided by rho. So this is buoyancy force per unit mass. So this term is nothing but buoyancy force per unit mass. So this is the term, is the only term where the expansion in pressure is accounted. In all other places, that is here and anywhere else in other equations, the rho remains constant. Now let's see how to write this as an expansion. So we write a Taylor expansion about the infinite density at infinity, at y equal to infinity. So it is straightforward. So rho equal to rho infinity plus partial rho by partial t times t minus t infinity. Why t minus t infinity? Because the temperature from infinity is it's colder in this case, and then it becomes hotter. So at any point here, the density is a function of the local temperature, and that is simply given by a linear approximation. And the higher order terms, or HOT, are ignored. So in the linear approximation, we just retain the first term. Substituting this in the previous equation, we get g beta t minus t infinity, where beta is nothing but 1 by rho, partial rho by partial t. And that is called as the thermal expansion coefficient. This is evaluated at constant pressure. And the other equation again we have is the energy equation, again same as the flat plate boundary layer equations. So you have alpha times partial square t by partial y square. Here again note alpha has a term which has got density k by rho cp. So that density, as well as density coming here mu by rho, both remain constant. So we don't do an expansion here. Only expansion for density is done for the buoyancy term. So this is the Bosanisk approximation. So we can render the equation dimensionless as before. The same notation we'll use. Eta is for x direction, c is for y direction, and u and v, the velocities, are dimensional velocities, capital U and capital V, are made dimensionless by a characteristic reference velocity u naught. Now, unlike in the case of forced convection, there is no imposed velocity. So we don't know what this velocity would be, but we will find it out when we simplify the equations. For now, we take it as some reference velocity. The temperature, dimensionless temperature definition remains the same, except for change in the sign here. And the Reynolds number and Prandtl number are all defined this way, except the Reynolds number again is defined in terms of this reference velocity. Now, substituting this in the equations, we have the governing equations as this. The left-hand side and this term remain the same as for flat plate. What we have additionally here is this constant times theta naught, theta, where theta is this dimensionless temperature. So in earlier equation for flat plate, we had only velocity terms. So the velocity term dependent only on other velocity terms. But here we have a double coupling. So velocity term also has, in this differential equation, an expression for theta. Now let us look at this term. So we saw that u naught is a reference velocity. We don't know a priori. So it, we can choose anything that we want. So if you look at this expression here, this has a unit of velocity square. Note all the terms are dimensionless. So this term is dimensionless. So this term on the numerator is velocity square. So we can conveniently choose u naught to be this square root of this. And delta Ts is nothing but Ts minus T infinity. That is surface temperature minus infinite temperature. And this velocity is a square root of this numerator, G beta delta T L. So substituting, making this expression for U naught. So this equation actually looks very simple here. So we have again a differential equation, which is coupled, partial differential equation coupled, because this is the equation for U, which has got terms for V. And this is a equation for theta, which has got U and V here. And theta comes here. So it's two-way coupled equations. Now let's look at the meaning of this dimensionless number that we have obtained by using this U naught. Now, if you look at Reynolds number, it is not the imposed velocity, but the natural velocity coming from the buoyancy forces. So this is called as a buoyancy velocity scale. So this is called as the velocity scale coming due to buoyancy. So if you substitute for U naught here, and then take square of Reynolds number. So Re square is U naught L by nu whole square. This term is G beta delta Ts L cube by nu square, substituting for U naught from here. And this number is denoted as GR or Grashof number. So Grashof number is nothing but square of the Reynolds number, but the velocity coming from a natural length scale of buoyancy driven flows. So naturally, all the convection correlations that we wrote for Reynolds number, Re power A and PR power B, will look similar, except that now since Re is GR power 1 by 2, this expression will be GR power A by 2 and PR power B. Now, in certain situations, we can have a combined effect of force and free convection. In that case, we'll have two velocity scale. One, velocity scale U naught, which we saw just now, which is coming from the free convection, and U infinity, which we saw earlier for flat plate, which was imposed velocity. Now, depending on the magnitude of these both, the equations could, terms in the equations could be small or large. So for convenience, we go back to the older definition of the velocity, dimensionless velocity, which is made dimensionless by U infinity instead of U naught. Then we will have Reynolds number as L U infinity by nu. And your equation, dimensionless equation, will now have a u square, u infinity square coming at the denominator here. And therefore, this term, if you see, is gr square, gr by re square is nothing but u naught square by u infinity square. So gr by re square is nothing but u naught square by u infinity square. So depending on the extent of your force convection, because this is in our control, which comes from externally, and this is comes naturally. So depending on the magnitude of these both, if u infinity is very large compared to u naught, okay, if u infinity is very large compared to u naught, then this term can be ignored. So essentially, we are back to the same flat plate velocity boundary layer, and we'll be solving this. That means that there is no natural natural convection velocity. However, if u infinity is much small compared to u naught, then we will be using the equations which we saw earlier, where Grashof number is redefined as your new Reynolds number square. In the general case, when these both are equal, u infinity and u naught are of the same order, then your Nusselt number is now a function of three parameters. Earlier, it was a function of only Re and Pr or Gr and Pr. Now, if both free and forced convections are of equal magnitude, then the correlations will have Re, Gr, and Pr, because those are the only parameters that are in this equation. We have Gr and Re, and in the thermal equations, we'll have Pr. So totally, we have three parameters. So Nusselt number is a function of three parameters in this case. To summarize, we saw Bosnick's approximation, which had two parts. Firstly, the velocity, the density can be made linear in terms of temperature, or in general in terms of concentration as well. And then the linearization approximation is applied only to the gravity term, and all other places where density comes, like in the viscosity or in thermal diffusivity, kinematic viscosity or thermal diffusivity, the density is taken to be a constant. We also saw that in the case of natural convection, we could find a natural velocity scale, and which was used to construct the Reynolds number. And the Reynolds number square turns out to be a new number called as the Grashof number, defined with respect to this velocity scale. Thank you.